Good morning, dear students. I hope you all are happy and safe at home. We have been discussing with the chapter units and measurements, and we have reached up to dimensional analysis. Also, we discussed the applications of dimensional analysis. Again, it is very important, so go through it. If you are not getting it, please contact me. Okay, and some students called me and cleared their doubt, and also most of them send the notes as well as the homework to me. So I'm very happy and keep doing. Okay, so today we'll move to a new topic, that is measurement of length, mass and time. Measurement of length, mass and time. As you know, the length, mass and time are the fundamental quantities. We are giving more importance to it. And how do we measure this length, or how do we measure mass, time, etc.? Okay, that is what first we are going to discuss. Okay, so we will move to the topic right now, that is measurement of length. For measuring the length can be small or it can be large. Isn't it? You have to measure smaller length as well as larger length. Now, the range of length that we could measure normally is around this, is 10 raised to minus 3 meter to 10 raised to 2 meters. So this much range we can measure with the help of a meter scale. Okay, that is, a meter scale is able to measure the range of 10 raised to minus 3 meters to 10 raised to 2 meters. Okay, with the help of a meter scale we can do that. But if the length is more than 10 raised to 2 meters, you have to opt for another method. Okay, so if the length is more than 2 meters, length is greater than 10 raised to 2 meters, we have to opt for a method known as parallax method. The method is called parallax method, that we have to discuss in detail. Now, for smaller length, for measuring the smaller length, we will use certain microscopes like electron microscope, tunneling microscope, etc. Okay, you can note down the points. Clear? So the normal range that we see around us is 10 raised to minus 3 meter to 10 raised to 2 meters, that we can measure with the help of certain devices as well as meter scale, etc. Now next is the length greater than 10 power 2 meters can be measured with the help of a method called parallax method. And also for smaller length we will use electron microscope, tunneling microscope, etc. Understand? Now we will move to the parallax method. We have to study the parallax method in detail. So before moving to the method, first you have to know what is a parallax. Okay, so I will write the definition and then I will explain. So parallax means the effect whereby the position or direction of an object appears to differ when viewed from different positions. Do you understand anything? I will explain. That is, if you want to look at a tree, if you want to measure the length of a length from the position of tree to the place or the point where you are standing. Okay. So, if you are measuring that particular length, by the method of parallax, what we are doing is, first you will close your right eye. Understand? You will close your right eye. Then you view through your left eye. Clear? Similarly, after closing the left eye, you will view through right eye. If now itself you can check that, if you are looking the if you are taking a pen and you place it like this, now close your left eye and view through the right, as well as close your right and look through the left. Surely you can see that there is a change in the position, isn't it? There is a change in the position when you are viewing through two different eyes, like left eye and right eye, for the same object. isn't it? So that's the method that we are doing here in the case of parallax method. That example that we took is for measuring the length from tree to the point where you are standing. So you can look the that particular tree by closing your left eye and viewing through your right, as well as closing your right and viewing through your left. Understand? So there will be a change in the position. So the change in the positions, there will be a small distance between these two positions, between the left and the right eye. Looking through left and right eye, there will be a change in the position, and that change or that difference in the positions, two positions, is called the basis. Okay, that difference in the two positions is called the basis. Okay, now you look the definition. The effect whereby the position or the direction of an object appears to differ when viewed from different positions. Now you understand, you are viewing from different positions means you are viewing through your left eye as well as with your right eye. So both times you are getting two different positions. Understand? The distance between those two different positions is known as the basis. Clear? So let us take an example where this is your, this is your left eye and this is your right eye, for example. Now you are viewing an object, isn't it? Now when you view an object which is placed here, there will be two positions for two eyes, isn't it? So for the left eye, you have a position here, as well as for right eye, you have a position here. The distance between these two is the basis, which we denote with the letter B, isn't it? Now, both for both, you have a particular angle, isn't it? Let the total angle be theta. Clear? Let the total angle between these two positions be taken as theta, and let D be this distance. Actually, you have to measure this D, isn't it? You have to measure the length called D. Okay, now listen, let us assume, assumption is there for physics, assumption is there. So here, we are assuming that this particular point O, let it be denoted as C. Okay, this is actually the center of a circle. Center of a circle, which means that, like this. Okay, the center of the circle where this distance is the radius. Understand? Now what is this? This is the arc length. Okay, and this is the angle. You got it? First we assumed that this point lies as the center of a circle. Understand? Now this distance is the radius of the circle, and this particular distance, basis, is the arc length. Clear? Now you have a general expression. Angle is equal to arc length divided by radius. Arc length divided by radius. So theta is equal to what? Arc length is B and radius is D. Isn't it? Now listen, this B, when compared to D, this B is very, very small. This B is very, very small, isn't it? So if I am taking the ratio B by D, it is always less than 1. Clear? Because B is always less than D. Very, very small when compared to D. Isn't it? So theta is equal to B by D. Understand? Now what is D? What is D? D is B by theta. D is B by theta. Okay? So this is actually the parallax method with which we can find the distance of an object from a point to the position where we are standing. Like this is an example for measuring the length or the distance of a tree. Okay. So this parallax method is also used to find the distance of a planet from the earth. Okay. So like that we can use this parallax method. Understand? Now in the laboratory we are using certain devices like screw gauge. Next, vernier calipers, then spirometer. These names may be new for you, So when you go to the lab, we will do it and you will get more familiarized with it. So now for the time, screw gauge. Screw gauge means it's a device which is used to measure small lengths. I already told that 10 raised to minus 3 to 10 raised to 2. Up to that we can measure, isn't it? Using meter scale and using some devices like screw gauge, vernier caliper, spirometer, etc. Screw gauge means it is used to measure the diameter of a small wire. Diameter of a wire, then thickness of a paper sheet. Okay, thickness of a paper sheet, similarly thickness of a glass plate. So these all can be measured with the help of a screw gauge. How we are doing that details and all we will discuss in the lab. Then vernier caliper, again another device which is used to measure the diameter of a bob. I told in the first test which we are using to do the experiment of simple pendulum. Okay, so bob, diameter of the bob, then oleum of a rectangular block, small things, right? Rectangular block, etc. So vernier caliper is used to do such things. Then spirometer is a device which is used to find the radius of curvature of a spherical surface. In the lab, we are using a convex lens and we are finding the radius of curvature of the convex lens using what? A spirometer. So these are the devices which are used to measure small lengths which we can measure. Understand? Now, again, if the distance is moving beyond 10 raised to minus, like 10 raised to minus 2 minus 5, like that, it is growing, means it is again getting too small. And for such cases, we are using microscopes and all. Understand? So, this is all about the measurement of length. How do we measure the length? So, keep it in mind. For small lengths, we will use microscopes and all. From 10 raised to minus 3 to 10 raised to 2, we will use meter scale. Then screw gauge, vernier caliper, spirometer, etc. And also to find what the distance is beyond 10 raised to 2 meters, we will use the method called parallax method, by which we can measure the distance of a planet from the earth. And like that, measurements can be done. Understand? Now we will discuss the range of lengths. Okay, range of length. Range of length. You know, there are, I already told that we have to measure small length as well as large length, isn't it? Small length in the sense, you know, atom. What is the size of an atom? Size of an atom is the order of 10 raised to minus 10 meters. For an atom, the size is about 10 raised to minus 10 meters. Understand? Now, a nucleus is present at the center, isn't it? Nucleus is again smaller than the size of atom. It is in the range of 10 raised to minus 15 meters. So, these are all small length. And this 10 raised to minus 15 meter is called 1 Fermi. 1 Fermi. Understand? 10 raised to minus 10 meter is called 1 angstrom. Okay? So, 1 Fermi is 10 power minus 15 meters and 1 angstrom is 10 power minus 10 meters. These are small length measurements. Understand? Now moving to the larger measurements, you may have heard the word like leap year, then astronomical unit, per second, etc. Okay. So, these are all larger units. What is leap year? Leap year means distance travelled by light in 1 year. It is actually the distance travelled by light in 1 year. And one leap year is equal to 9.46 into 10 power, 15 meters. Look here, how much big it is. Okay, one leap year is equal to 9.46 into 10 power 15 meters. And how will you define leap year? It is a distance traveled by the light in 1 year. Distance traveled by the light in 1 year. Understand? Now, the second unit is astronomical unit. And one astronomical unit can be defined as a distance between. Distance between sun and the earth. Distance between sun and earth. Understand? Astronomical unit is defined as the distance between sun and earth, and one astronomical unit is about 1.47 into 10 power 11 meters. Okay, one astronomical unit is 1.47 into 10 power 11 meters. Like that, parsec is also used as a higher unit or a larger unit to measure the length. Understand? So these are the range of lengths, starting from smaller to the larger units of, sorry, range of length. Understand? Okay, so leap year and astronomical unit. Leap year means what? The distance traveled by the light in 1 year. And astronomical unit means it is a distance between sun and earth, which is 1.47 into 10 power 11 meters. And one light year is 9.46 into 10 power 15 meters. You have to study these values, okay? Because there will be, in some cases, there will be need of conversion from leap year to meter or from astronomical unit to meter. At that time, you must know this value so that it will be easy for you. Okay. Now, we will move to certain conversions of units. Okay. Relationship between the units. Study a single unit, that is radian. Radian, you know. What is radian? You have studied it as a supplementary unit while we discuss the fundamental unit. Radian means what? It is the standard unit used to measure the angle. Isn't it? You know. It is the standard unit used to measure the angle. Okay. So this is the radius and this is the arc length, which can be denoted by L. So theta is the angle. Angle theta is equal to what? Which is equal to L by R, where arc length by radius. And this angle theta has a standard unit called radian. But you know other units like degree, you know, right? So there should be some conversion between this degree and radian, isn't it? How much radian is equal to 1 degree? Or how much degree is equal to 1 radian. Like that you must know. Understand? That is what we are going to discuss now. So, radian, 1 radian can be expressed as, how can you express? 1 unit of arc length divided by 1 unit of radius. Clear? So, 1 radian can be expressed as 1 unit of arc length by 1 unit of radius. Clear? Now you know that for a full circle, okay, for a full circle, what about this arc length? This arc length will be, what is the length? It will be the total circumference of the circle, isn't it? So, for a full circle, I can write, it is 2 pi r, isn't it? 2 pi r divided by, what is the radius? R. So, I can say that for a full circle, it must be equal to 2 pi radians. The value is 2 pi radians. Clear? Now, for a circle, you know what is the total angle? In mathematics, you have studied that for a circle, the total angle is equal to 360 degree, isn't it? 360 degree. So, 1 degree, how can you write? 1 degree is 2 pi radian divided by 360, isn't it? 1 degree is 2 pi by 360, which is pi by 180. Clear? So, these conversions you must be aware of. Now, the third unit is arc minute. Okay, arc minute. arc minute means 1 degree is equal to 60 minutes. Isn't it? 1 degree equal to 60 minutes. And if you are converting it into radians, you will get 1.745 into 10 power minus 2 radians. 1.745 into 10 power minus 2 radians. Clear? And the fourth one is arc second. Arc second, which is 1 minute is equal to 60 seconds. So this is used to denote seconds and this is used to denote minute. Clear? So these are the conversions for what? The unit called radian. So radian can be converted into degree as well as arc minute, arc second, like that you can do. Okay, this must also you should take care of. Understand? So first is radian. Radian is the standard unit of what? Angle. Radian is a standard unit of angle. RAD is used to represent the angle. Okay. Now this radian can be converted to degree. Like 1 degree equal to pi by 180 radians. 1 degree is equal to pi by 180 radians. If it is 30 degree, how will you convert? 30 degree means pi by 180 into 30. Isn't it? So you will get pi by 6. Pi by 6. So this is all about what? The relationship between the units. Okay. So we studied how to measure the length. What are the range of length? And then relationship between the units. Now we are moving to the measurement of mass. Measurement of mass. Measurement of mass. You know mass, it is one of the fundamental quantities. What is the SI unit of mass? It is kilogram. So kilogram is the SI unit of mass. But kilogram cannot be used to measure smaller masses like mass of an electron, mass of a proton. It is very difficult, isn't it? By using kilogram, it is very difficult to measure smaller masses. So to measure smaller masses, a new unit was introduced. You may have heard in chemistry, that is atomic mass unit. Atomic mass unit. We denote it as AMU or U. Okay, AMU or U. So this atomic mass unit is a unit which is used to measure smaller masses. Now what is atomic mass unit? One atomic mass unit can be defined as, it is 1 by 12th of mass of a carbon 12 atom. Carbon 12 means it is the isotope of carbon, isn't it? So 1 AMU or 1 atomic mass unit is defined as 1 by 12th of mass of a carbon 12 atom. Understand? Now for smaller masses, you will use a device like mass spectrometer. For measuring the smaller masses like mass of an electron and all, we will use a measure device called mass spectrometer. And for large or heavy mass, you will use a method called gravitational method that you will study in the chapter gravitation. So now just know the name. Okay. So for measuring the heavy masses, we will use a method called gravitational method. Understand? So again, measurement of masses done by smaller masses by mass spectrometer, then heavy masses by using the method gravitational method, then the SI unit of mass is kilogram. Atomic mass unit is used to measure the smaller masses. It is a unit used to express the smaller masses. 1 AMU is 1 by 12th of the mass of a carbon 12 atom. Understand? Now here also the range of mass you should know. You know the mass of electron, proton, etc. What is the mass? Mass of an electron, what is the mass? You know, mass of an electron is 9.1 into 10 power minus 31 kilogram. Actually, it is measured in AMU and then converted to kilogram. Okay, so this, look here, the range is 10 raised to minus 31. So that much small it is, isn't it? So 10 power minus 31 is the smallest range of mass. From 10 power minus 31 to 10 power 55, up to that we are supposed to measure. Actually, 10 power 55 can be considered as the mass of the whole universe. Isn't it? So, there is a very large variation for the range of masses, like 10 power minus 30 or minus 31 to 10 power 55. So, there are such variations in the range of masses also, like the range of lengths. Understand? So, that's all about the measurement of mass. Now, we will move to measurement of time. Measurement of time. So, measurement of time is, time is another fundamental quantity whose unit is, SI unit is what? Second. So, second is the unit used to measure time. In olden days, actually the time was measured by considering the vibrations of cesium atom. Vibrations of cesium atom. You may have heard this cesium clock, isn't it? It is placed in where? It is an atomic clock. Okay. So, the vibrations of the this atomic clock. In the atomic clock, cesium atom is present. And the vibrations of this cesium atom is taken as what? The measurement of time. And how much vibrations it is making. That is a very large number. Just you know that. This much vibrations is made, or it is considered as 1 second. Okay, 1 second means this much vibrations of cesium atom. Okay, so 1 second, how will you define? It is actually the vibrations of the cesium atom present in a atomic clock. And how much vibrations are considered as 1 second? It is 9192631770 vibrations is considered as 1 second. Understand? So that's all about measurement of time. These are all basic knowledge. Just go through it. Okay. And we will move to the next topic, which is very important. That is accuracy and precision. Accuracy and precision. Okay. You may have heard the word accuracy. You may have heard the word precision. But how this accuracy and precision can be explained in physics? That is what we are going to discuss. Okay, in measurement, how this accuracy and precision is coming. Okay. Okay, the first term is accuracy. Accuracy means what? We are actually discussing with measurement, isn't it? So, we have to measure a large number of quantities. In the lab, we are doing so many experiments. And we are taking a large number of observations for each experiment. If you are doing an experiment like simple pendulum, and you will be taking large number of observations there. Why we are taking large number of observations? Why couldn't we finish it by taking only one observation? What is the difference, or why we are taking large number of observations? Can you suggest? As it is to get the most accurate value, isn't it? You know, in simple pendulum, you are finding the value of acceleration due to gravity. You know the value of acceleration due to gravity. It is 9.8 meter per second square, isn't it? 9.8 meter per second square. We are measuring this acceleration due to gravity by the experiment called simple pendulum. While we do this experiment, we may be getting different values because of so many factors that we will discuss later. So, this value is the true value, or this value is the actual value, isn't it? Now, I am taking so many observations in which I am getting the values like 9.75, okay, 9.76, understand? Then 9.9, like this I am getting the observations. Now, accuracy means how close the values are with the true value. How much close the values, the measured values with the true value. That is what called accuracy. Understand? So look here, in this particular set you can see that this 9.76 is more closer to 9.8. In the case of 9.9, there is 0.1 difference, isn't it? But here it is only 0.04 difference. So that much accurate it is, isn't it? So you can consider which value is more accurate when compared to the true value, or when compared to the actual value. Understand? That is called accuracy. So how will you define accuracy? Accuracy means how close is the measured value, how close is the measured value with the true value. Understand? How close is the measured value with the true value? That is what called accuracy. Don't forget. Understand? Now we will move to the second term, that is precision. Precision means what? Precision means a slight difference only. Look here. Precision means, here we are having so many values, isn't it? For getting the true value like 9.8, you are having so many values, and finally you will take the average and write it as your result, isn't it? Now while we are taking so many values, we will compare each value. We will compare with each other. 9.75 and 9.76. Again 9.76 and 9.9. We will compare each other and we will take how much close the measured values are. How much close the measured values are. That is what called precision. Okay. So comparison between these measured values is called what? Precision. Or how close the measured values are with each other. Understand? How close the measured values are with each other. That is what called precision. Okay. Now you are able to differentiate between accuracy and precision. Can I hope so? Okay. So that's all for today. We will check the balance of the topic in the next class. Have a nice day and thank you.